weed business is big business. Cannabis, once considered a heavy drug worthy of criminalization and long prison sentences for distribution, is now saving states from falling off of the fiscal cliff. Colorado passed $1 billion in state marijuana revenue in 2019 alone. And take a look at just how well top marijuana selling states are doing. Raking in the cash. But while state governments are using the ganja to stay afloat, the business isn't without heavy regulation, scandal, and corruption. Turns out, giving local elected officials the power to decide who gets access to the multi-million dollar marijuana business created a sea of bribery and illegal activity led by the gatekeepers themselves. One of those gatekeepers was Jaziel Correa, a rising Democratic Party star and former mayor of Fall River, Massachusetts. In 2019, just a few days shy of his own reelection race, federal agents handcuffed Correa in his home. He was charged with attempting to extort cannabis companies of $600,000 in exchange for the highly coveted and lucrative weed-selling licenses. Correa, along with staffers and friends, accepted a variety of bribes, including cash, more than a dozen pounds of marijuana, and a Batman Rolex watch worth up to $12,000. Almost all states require approval of local officials before marijuana licenses are even given. And those local officials can't seem to resist bribes or favors. But it isn't just a local problem. Allegations of corruption run rampant at the state level too, where commissioning bodies are in charge of deciding who gets the small number of marijuana licenses available. Former Maryland state leader Cheryl Glenn is serving a 2-year prison sentence after being convicted in July of taking bribes and introducing legislation to benefit medical marijuana companies. Missouri Governor Mike Parson's administration is currently the target of law enforcement and legislative probes in the rollout of its medical marijuana program. Not only are the gatekeepers dealing in the dark, but minority-led weed businesses are not receiving fair consideration or even consideration at all in most cases. Joining us now to tell us more are co-founder of the Green Toad Hemp Farm, Dwayne Hirsch, and legal analyst Mollye Barrows. Welcome. Mollye,
hi, Ameshia.
Hey, I'll start with you, Mollye. There seems to be a whole slew of requirements and red tape for cannabis entrepreneurs, but the state and local elected officials seem to be given carte blanche control. How can corruption be mitigated when in most cases our elected leaders make 50K or less and are heavily enticed by these bribes and honestly cuts of weed profits as well?
Yes, you're exactly right. And we're seeing story after story across the country as more and more states continue to legalize marijuana. But there are a couple of schools of thought as what steps need to be taken to increase oversight, as well as just cut down on these opportunities for corruption, and especially when it comes to local control. So there really hasn't been any directive as to how local control should work. So a lot of states, a lot of communities are making it up as they go when it comes to creating safeguards and regulations, like who's going to make these decisions on who gets a license, how will they be awarded, how will these permits be awarded. So one idea is to just eliminate the caps altogether. You have less opportunity for corruption if there are fewer caps to compete for, if you will. And there's also the idea of creating some oversight through legislation. There was a bill that was pitched, installed in Massachusetts last year, but there are plans to reintroduce it this upcoming year, which would create more oversight of agreements between local community governments and companies seeking to do business with them, more transparency. So hopefully there would be less opportunity for maybe some, you know, bribery, if you will, paying over the cap, giving extras, like maybe paying for a festival or something like that, like you've heard in other communities. So they're looking at different ideas, but so far there really hasn't been any hard steps taken. But, you know, some of the states where you're seeing not very many problems with corruptions are the ones that don't have those caps on licenses. So they've certainly found a way around it by limiting those opportunities for corruptions, not giving or like giving them away through a lottery process.
Dwayne, I want to ask you, you're co-owner of a hemp farm. Now, of course, licensing for hemp is far different, but in many ways, the state hurdles and red tape can mirror, you know, getting licensed to operate in the cannabis industry. How was your experience working in that competitive market to receive a license? And look, we all know black farmers are less than 1.4% of the country's 3.2 million farmers. As a black man in this market that has few faces of color, what unique hurdles would you say you've faced, and do you have advice for others?
it may surprise you all to know that we really didn't face any hurdles that were unique to us because we were African-American. Hemp is a federally legal product and is treated as an agricultural commodity. So it played out a little bit different with the way my business partner, Reginald Reese, went out and was able to acquire that license. But we didn't really overcome any other major hurdles to that. We're very aware of the ones that are going on in places like Illinois and some of the other states that are coming online. But and part of the reasons why we started in the hemp industry was just because it was not mired in all of that confusion and madness, if you will.
Mm-hmm. And Mollye, we're seeing more and more cases of corruption, like we spoke of, from state legislators, not just the local leaders. But now we're talking about governors and House and Senate leadership and state legislatures that actually control the bills that are ultimately going to regulate the industry. Those folks are taking bribes themselves and letting the marijuana company owners draft the bills that are supposed to be regulating their businesses. Can you explain the legal issues associated with this and what federal laws would have to be implemented to upend this process?
Well, basically, it's corruption, pure and simple. They shouldn't be allowed to regulate themselves. And I think part of the problem is it's like the Wild West, because marijuana is still illegal on a federal level. So until marijuana is legalized on a federal level and there's a uniform system of nationwide regulation of this industry, it's going to continue to be piecemeal. It's going to continue to be what states want to do state by state, county by county, if you will, community by community. So until you all these states are just going to continue to take different approaches and make those limited number of licenses even more valuable. So in order to really get to the root of this problem, legalizing marijuana at the federal level, establishing that uniform system of nationwide regulation would help address some of those corruption issues, provide safety and business standards like any other industry to maintain and enforce. I mean, Ameshia, this is a $52 billion industry. It's like the Wild West. They're all going to be trying to grab a piece of this pie until somebody says, you can't do that. And there's some regulation and accountability, transparency in the licensing process, basically getting government out of the business of picking winners and losers and allowing the market to dictate what customers want.
Dwayne, hemp farming really exploded after 2018 Farm Bill passed, decriminalizing the plant at a federal level. We all know that CBD oils and things of that nature, that's also a booming business and is sold pretty much across the country. Your Green Toad Hemp Farm is the first Georgia-licensed hemp farm. What changes in laws have you encountered that have affected your business growth, or what would you like to see in this industry moving forward?
Well, one of the things that's going on right now is Senator Rand Paul from Kentucky just introduced what's called the Hemp Act, which will extend the amount of legal THC that's allowed in the hemp plant, and it would take it to a 1% level versus the current 0.3. There's a lot of debate over the veracity of the 0.3 and its effectiveness in the products that we put out. It is very effective, but it could certainly be more effective without creating that psychoactive compound that they're trying to avoid in hemp products. So that's one of the things that we really like to see. In terms of what's happened since the rule in the state of Georgia, things have pretty much gone pretty well. They haven't really beat anybody up. They've really tried to work with farmers here and try to make sure everybody understands it and that they can work together to have a more perfect union, if you will, between the farmers and the state. So right now, it's been okay. That might change in years to come as things kind of uptick and get a little bit more busy. But right now, it's been a pretty cool environment and one that we've been happy to function in and happy to be helpful to our local officials and helping them understand the industry so that they can legislate more effectively.
Let me ask you this. Would there be a change to your industry if suddenly on a federal level they said, okay, we're going to take cannabis and legalize it across the board, or at least regulate it across the board and mimic what we've done in those states like California, Colorado that we've heard so much about? How would that affect your business and the hemp side of the business as opposed to the cannabis side?
Interestingly enough, I believe that it would help our industry in terms of user engagement, validity for the validation that consumers need to come after and see about hemp as and CBD as a product and as a medicinal tool for themselves. The concern I would have is that if it went federally legal, the same people in my community who do not have the funding and the capital and the other instruments that you need to go into the cannabis industry legally are not there. So if we're already getting kicked out of opportunities in different states or left out on a federal level, that would only accelerate because, again, that lack of resources and other connectivity points is still there, and even on a broader scale. But for us, if it did go legal, we'd be happy because ultimately, we believe that most people do not want the psychoactive effect that marijuana or cannabis can give you. We believe that most people just want a simple relief for their anxiety and an opportunity to relieve their medical issues in a very simple way, and one that's not going to cause them undue issues in one way or another. So we think that it actually would be helpful because it'll bring more users into the space and create a comfort, a validated comfort for people to even start to look at products that we have.
Well, I want to thank you both so much for coming on today and educating our audience on this subject matter. Once again, Dwayne Hirsch, co-founder of the Green Toad Hemp Farm, and legal analyst Mollye Barrows. Thank you both for coming on today.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.